Hi, and welcome to the Chicago Tribune Newsroom. I'm Mike Kellums. I'm joined today by Brian Hamilton and Steve Rosenblum. The Hawks are off today and traveling to Los Angeles, but we're going to talk about them anyway. Brian was at the game last night. Steve watched it from his garage or his dining room or wherever we like to keep him, wherever he happens to be today. Brian, from what you've seen so far in the first couple of games, it's somewhat reminiscent of the first game of the Detroit series. Flying high, a lot of confidence. What do you think so far about what you've seen?
I think hockey is a weird sport, and things yep. change awful quickly, which is what we saw in the last round when the Hawks looked dead and buried, and they obviously came back to advance nevertheless. But I look at a Blackhawks team that is, in my mind, playing a complete game, back to front, playing as well as they have all year. And while I still think the Kings are equipped in a lot of ways to beat them and can beat them, and I think they're still in the series given how good they are at home, I really don't see how Los Angeles wins 4 out of 5 games against this Blackhawks team if the Blackhawks play reasonably close to the level they're playing at right now. If they're playing their best hockey, which it looks like they may be peaking at this point, I think they're making the Stanley Cup final given the situation they're in right now. I don't see how Los Angeles, as well equipped as they are with physicality, with the potential for really elite level goaltending and toughness on the back end, I don't see how they win 4 out of 5 against the Hawks, with the Hawks playing even close to the level they're at right now.
Steve?
I'm with Brian on this. Jonathan Quick might come back and stop 45 shots and shut out the Blackhawks in game 3. But when you look at what's transpired in the first 2 games, the Blackhawks have taken their game and smothered the Kings, and the Blackhawks have taken the Kings game and beat them up with it. The Kings were supposed to be the physical team, right. The bigger team. Right. The Kings are the ones that suffered more injuries, more critical injuries, and the Hawks are the one that responded with physical play. And when the Kings tried to get there, they couldn't. They're not fast enough to get there to abuse the Hawks. That's what we're seeing and what Brian's talking about. You go back to that dire situation in the Detroit series, they're down 3-1. They won 5 in a row. They've scored 16 goals in that time. You have to go back 3 weeks to find 16 goals for the Kings. And you look at who's scoring. 3 by Andrew Shaw, 3 by Brian Bickell.
Right.
The Kings can't get 3 goals from Andrei Kopitar, their number one center. That's where the talent gap, which started very wide, is getting bigger with every Hawks role player chipping in and defenseman, and with every Hawks injury, starting with Mike Richards, their number 2 center, who had 9 points in the last 11 games. This is, I'm not saying it's going to be a sweep. I'm not saying it's a rout, but everything the Hawks want to do against Jonathan Quick, they've scored on the rush. They've scored on rebounds. They've scored with hard forechecking. They've scored in transition. You name it, they've done it, and they've finished, and it's everybody who's finishing for the Hawks.
Right, and the Kings are a very different team at home. They're, if I have the schedule right in my head, they're undefeated at home and can't seem to win a game on the road except if it's against the Blues, and that was in Game 5 of that series. The San Jose series was home ice, 1 out throughout, which would, if that's the case in this series, that means the Hawks still advance since they have home ice in Game 7 would be at the United Center. They do seem like a completely different team. Brian, the Hawks are off today, as I said. They will talk to the media. What was nice about the schedule for the Wings in the last round was that they had a couple days off to reset. Today is the first chance, because of the compressed first 2 games at the United Center back-to-back, that the Kings have had a chance to reset. Any early thoughts on what Daryl Sutter might be thinking about to sort of change the momentum heading into Game 3 at the Staples Center?
Yeah, it's interesting. I think just going home for one thing will help. I mean, if you look at this just sort of from the way these things tend to go, you know that the Kings are going to come out incredibly desperate with the energy of their home crowd. And as cliche as that sounds, it winds up being true more often than not. And even if the Hawks have an uphill battle in Game 3, maybe they get their desperation level up for Game 4, assuming they lose on Tuesday night. And then that's sort of what really turned the series. But more than anything, when the Kings get on the ice in about 4 hours from now, 12 o'clock Pacific time, you got to see if Mike Richards is out there. I mean, they're going to play Jonathan Quick again, obviously. He's going to be back in there. It's not even a question.
Sure.
But to me, I'm not smart enough about hockey to really diagnose just exactly how the absence of Mike Richards hurt them last night. But there was a lot of open ice, a lot of open ice for the Blackhawks last night. And that is absolutely, I mean, proved deadly, and it is absolutely deadly when you give that fast a team with that much scoring depth, that much ice. And I got to think that in some ways, when you have Richards yanked out of there, really right after warmups, I mean, Daryl Sutter said after the game, he walked in, saw Mike Richards. Mike Richards had some symptoms, as he put it, and he said, you're not going to play if you're not 100%. So right before the puck drop, you lose your number two center guy, a guy who's a solid two-way player, top shelf talent. I got to think that filtered down to your defensively, just in terms of chemistry and reliability and knowing where other guys are going to be at certain times. Again, there are probably much smarter hockey guys out there who can go back and diagnose X's and O's why the Hawks had that much time. But I got to think that when you pluck a guy like Richards out of there, the domino effect of who everybody is used to playing with is really detrimental to the Kings. So, I mean, I want to see if Mike Richards is back out there in 4 hours, because, I mean, that to me is a huge pivot point for what happens on Tuesday.
Sure. Richards has a history of concussion problems. I'd be surprised if he's out there today. I'd be surprised if he plays. They seem to get worse. They get exponentially worse. And you're right about the open ice. Richards is only partially responsible for it. He's the guy that they would love to turn into Henrik Zetterberg and annoy Jonathan Toews, because Anje Kopitar isn't capable of doing that. Now, they'll have the last change when they get to L.A., the Kings will, for games 3 and 4. But the reason there was so much open ice is the Blackhawks went up the middle. The Kings want to play the game against the boards. They want to squash them like bugs against a windshield. And the Hawks, that shows you what kind of confidence they had. It cost them when Dave Bolin tried to shovel the puck up the middle and Justin Williams scored. But the Hawks are willing to go up the middle. Defensemen, forwards, doesn't matter who it is, quick little passes. You saw some really nifty plays. They're going to go up the middle if the Kings are going to give it to them. And that's how much confidence they have. That's a dangerous place to have a turnover, and it's cost them before. But they're skating really well, and the Kings are not fast enough to recover to shut down the middle of the ice if they're playing the boards and they want to work the cycle along the glass.
Yeah, I think that's all right. You know, I think as euphoric as Hawks fans might be feeling right now, they should look back only to the series just before and how you felt after game one against the Wings. It could be a different series when they get back. Daryl Sutter certainly has confidence, as they have 5 more games to play in 10 days, so he thinks it's going the distance. We will certainly see. Brian Hamilton, Steve Rosenblum, thank you for joining me today. For all you Chicago Tribune readers out there, be sure to pick up copy of the sports section today. Our poster for today is Brian Bickell. He had the game winner last night to put the Hawks up 2-0, and we'll see you again real soon. Thanks for your time.
It's huge for us. What the heck was that? I think we expected them to be better than they were in game one, and they were. We raised our play too, and made some tiny little mistakes where we didn't get the puck deep, and we corrected that, and we stayed with our game that we wanted to play. And once we got up a few goals, we knew that we didn't have to score more, but we didn't want to change our game too much. So just the way we played in game two, I think we know it's going to get tougher and tougher, especially going into their building. So we'll find that next level like we did tonight.